Christ. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything you are enriched by him in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, I remember going down towards Springfield. There's a sign down there, First Corinthians Baptist Church. What would ever possess somebody to call himself First Corinthians Baptist Church? That was the most carnal church at that time, amen? This is 30 years, a little less than 30 years after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. There were people that were still alive then that could have been eyewitnesses to the graves opening up and the people walking around Jerusalem and everything else. Amen? And heard from people that were eyewitnesses to this. And yet, they were getting drunk at the Lord's table. I mean, you know, they having the Lord's table, they were serving grape juice, right? They were getting drunk off of grape juice. And I'll tell you what, some of these pastors, man, Billy Sunday was the one that preached on the bottle and everything.
Right.
Amen. And people started going by that, but the Bible doesn't say that. I'm not going there. But I want you to turn over to chapter 3. Paul says in verse 1, "And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able. For ye are yet carnal, for whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men? For while one saith, I am of Paul, and another, I am of Apollos, are ye not carnal? Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom ye believed, even as the Lord gave to every man? I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor." Okay, he's dealing with winning people to the Lord here. He said some plant, some water, God gives the increase. He said every man is going to be rewarded for his labor. What kind of reward are you looking for? Huh? How have you labored? Do you know that the local church is the pillar and ground of the truth? We're supposed to be alive in our community. This is our bishopric. Amen? This is our area. The problem we have is that they came along with automobiles, messed everything up. So people go clear across town to go to church. Amen? Mm-hmm. Or what church has the nicest building? Mm-hmm. What church has the most handsomest preacher? Well, you got that one beat down. I mean, hands down, right? Who's got the nicest piano? I say we do. Anyway. But people, they go to church sometimes for the wrong reason. How many were here and we held tent meetings out here? Just Brother Dave and Phil. Amen? We used to have tent meetings right down there at the road. Friday night, we'd do a hog. We just pick one of the congregation. No, but we'd do a hog. Amen. We'd have preachers come in, more than one. We'd have a good time all week long. We used to set it up here on number 6, right there where the, what's there now? I can't even think of what's there now. It used to be a little store up there. And the man would let us use his property, Cecil Rowland, the one that screamed, "Don't let him take me, preacher," when he died, when he was dying. "Don't let him take me." He said they was grabbing at his feet. But he never wanted to listen, but he would let us use that property to set up the tent. He'd tell us that the people in the store would get upset sometimes because every time we set that tent up, nobody would buy their beer. You know what? God starts sending people in. People from around the neighborhood, even. We had people, they see the tent up, they'd stop. But we've been dormant for quite a while. I bet not one of us have knocked on the door of the new neighbor yet. But we want to see souls saved. Amen? Shame on us. Don't wait till they drive off and then go knock on the door.
Huh? Tommy didn't even know we had one.
What, a door?
A neighbor.
Oh.
He was my foot neighbor.
The new house. Right next to our church. I've talked to these people because they were kind enough to tell us about the woman who threw the rock through the window there. Amen. I invited them to church. But they're down there building the fire tonight. Got a little pumpkin out there or something. But what are we doing? If every man is going to receive his own reward, what kind of reward are you expecting? You see, you say, "Well, I tithe." Well, you're supposed to. Amen? You say, will a man rob God? You say, "How have we robbed you?" It says in tithes and offerings. Amen? I heard one church, my son-in-law's dad, he didn't believe in tithes. He said that was Old Testament, under the law. But you know it's not, because Abraham was paying tithes before there was a law. And he's doing it in Melchizedek. So you say, "Well, I tithe and I come to church." Well, that's just your duty. You're supposed to. Amen. But what have you done for the Lord? Where have you stepped out, even when you're tired, or you don't feel like it, or you'd rather do something else, and said, "Hey, I'm going to do what God commanded me to do. I'm going to try to win somebody." What happened to people like D.L. Moody that would wake up and realize he hadn't witnessed somebody that day and get up at midnight and go down the street to find somebody to tell him about Jesus? We don't have those kind of burdens. We got time for everything else. "Well, my body aches." Well, so does mine. That doesn't stop you from doing the things you want to do. What about what the Lord wants us to do? We've got to get busy again if we want to see any fruit for our labors. When's the last time that we put together baskets and everything for the nursing homes on the holidays? We haven't done that in a couple years. Huh? I know, but when we could, we had quit. But you still can take it to them and drop it off, and they'll take it in. Amen? Right? I don't know, they do it at Rogers. They do it at Brother Rog. Anybody tried it? Give them a call. See if you can drop off something. You know, Doesn't hurt to try if you really want to do something. But I know that people don't want us knocking on their doors because of this coronavirus, but we do have that little box of door hangers. Put a track in it and a booklet or a pamphlet or something to take, hang it on the door. Then run like crazy. Hey, you did it as a kid, didn't you? Remember you set a bag of dog manure on fire and ring the doorbell and run? You remember that? You never did that? You never had no fun, did you? You're a protected child. Did I give you any ideas? Oh, well, I didn't want to do that. Anyway, he says, chapter 3 and verse 9, he says, "For we are laborers together with God." Who are we laborers together with?
God.
Well, when have we labored with God lately? You're God's husbandry. You're God's building. "According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's works shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire." Now what happens when you put gold, silver, and precious stones in the fire? It purifies it. Amen. Fire's not going to destroy it. But wood, hay, and stubble? Shoo. "Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are." I believe there's a lot of sick Christians out there that are sick because they defiled the temple. Amen? I said this. The Bible says, "And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment." We've got an appointment with death. Amen? And I said this, we could either walk to the grave or we could be carried to it. It's all in how we treat our temple. Amen? I haven't treated mine very well. It needs remodeled.
Too late, brother. It's in hard decay.
I can't argue with that. "Let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seemeth to be wise in this world, let him become a fool, that he may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, for it is written, He taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. Therefore let no man glory in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world, or life or death, all things or things present or things to come, all are yours. And you are Christ, and Christ is God's." Now, look at chapter 5. Paul's given this. You know, Paul said before, he said, "I stand in doubt of you." He said, "Examine yourself, see if you be of the faith." But chapter 5, verse 1. Now, this is in the church now. It says, "It is reported commonly that there is fornication among you." So they got this thing going on in fornication in the church. "And such fornication as is not so much as named among the Gentiles, that one should have his father's wife." Now, if you had your father's wife, who have you had? Your mother. Amen? I've had some black folk use a curse word that included the word mother. And I said, "Let me show you the first one in the Bible." Amen? They said, "What you talking about, man?" I said, "Come here, let me show you." And ye are puffed up. They're puffed up about this. They're glorying in it. And he says, and have not rather mourned that he that hath done this deed might be taken away from among you. Now, what's he mean, taken away from among you? The Bible says there is a sin unto death of the believer. Amen? He says, I say not that you should pray for it, but there is a sin unto death to the believer. Do you know that when we take communion again, you better have your life cleaned up? If you're saved, you've got sin in your life, and we take communion, the Bible says some are sickly and some sleep. In other words, you die. Now, he says, you have not rather mourned that he hath done this deed might be taken away from among you. For I verily, as absent in the body, but present in the spirit, have judged already as though I were present concerning him that has so done this deed. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together in my spirit with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, to deliver such a one unto Satan for destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Paul didn't say he lost his salvation. See, if you're sealed into the day of redemption by that Holy Spirit of promise, you can't lose it. But you can sin the sin unto death. So he said to turn him over to Satan for destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. He said, your glorying is not good. Know you not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? Purge out, therefore, the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. He said, I wrote unto you in an epistle not to company with fornicators, yet not altogether with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or with idolaters, for then must ye needs go out of the world. But now I have written unto you not to keep company of any man that is called a brother, be a fornicator. Look what he adds right in there with it, or covetous. Covetous. Or an idolater, or a railer, or a drunkard, or an extortioner, with such a one know not to eat. For what have I to do to judge them also that are without? Do not ye judge them that are within? What, you ever hear that thing? Judge not, lest thou be judged. What's it say we're to do? We judge those that are within. And you go before them by the mouth of two or three witnesses. The way it should work, if it's a secret sin, is a brother goes before to them privately, says something to them. If they continue, then they take a witness. And then lastly, they bring them before the church. He says, but them that are without, God judges. Therefore, put away from among yourselves that wicked person. So what's he saying? We judge him within. If they continue, we put them out, turn them over to Satan for destruction of the flesh. Why? Because those that are without, God judges. But as long as they're under the umbrella of the church, God can't do anything. Do you realize that? If we don't do our part. There's a lot of people under the umbrella of the church. And then I've seen them blow out. And then you see the wrath of God, the judgment of God. I shouldn't say the wrath, the judgment. Now, he goes on to tell us, he said, dare any of you having a matter against another go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints shall judge the world, and if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Know you not that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? If then you have judgments of things pertaining to this life, set them to judge who are least esteemed in the church. I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? No, not one that shall be able to judge between his brethren. He says, but brother goeth to law with brother, and that before the unbelievers. That's such a bad thing when two Christians can't work their things out with the Word of God. I told my son that. I said, what do you think this looks like to the world? Because we're having a disagreement about certain things. And I said, we ought to be able to work it out between us if we're saved. Now, I did say this. I said, what I said was true. How I said it was wrong. And for that, I repent. Amen? But like I said, pillow talk's stronger than pulpit talk. Never seen any repentance on that part. But it looks bad on the church. Here's the pastor and here's his son. Amen. They can't think, work things out with Scripture. Now, I know the Bible says live peaceably with all men if possible. That some just ain't going to be let you live peaceably. And some things you're not going to work out because pride gets in the way. Amen. But we ought to be able to. Now, what do you think happened to this man here? Let's go to 2 Corinthians.
Verse 7.
Yeah, I was looking at verse chapter 1 for something. All right, chapter 1 and verse 3 and 4. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comfort us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. Now, God wants us to comfort one another, but not if you're living in your sin. Over in chapter 2, in verse 1, Paul says, but I determined this with myself, that I would not come again to you in heaviness. For if I make you sorry, who is he then that maketh me glad, but the same which is made sorry by me? And I wrote this same unto you, lest when I came, I should have sorrow from them of whom I ought to rejoice, having confidence in you all, that my joy is the joy of you all. For out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote unto you with many tears, not that you should be grieved, but that you might know the love which I have more abundantly unto you. But if any have caused grief, he hath not grieved me, but in part, that I may not overcharge you all. Now he says, sufficient to such a man as the punishment was inflicted of many. He's dealing with the man there in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 that they turned over Satan for destruction of the flesh and the church put him out. Amen? He says, so that contrariwise you ought rather to forgive him and comfort him, lest perhaps such a one should be swallowed up with overmuch sorrow. Wherefore I beseech you that you would confirm your love toward him. Now, this man committed a very gross sin. But now Paul said, turn him over to Satan for destruction of the flesh. Now he's saying, comfort him. Why? The man repented. He says, wherefore I beseech you that you would confirm your love toward him. For to this end also did I write, that I might know the proof of you, whether you be obedient in all things. Paul says, hey, I did it. See if you're going to be obedient. No doubt he had family members. I mean, we know his mother was there. So I'm sure he had other relatives. Amen. He says, to whom you forgive anything, I forgive also. For if I forgave anything to whom I forgave it, for your sakes forgave I it in the person of Christ, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, and the door was opened unto me of the Lord, I had no rest in my spirit because I found not Titus, my brother. But taking my leave of them, I went from thence into Macedonia. Now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish. To the one we are the savor of death unto death, and to the other the savor of life unto life. And who is sufficient for these things? For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God. Somebody's Bible said we're not as many as peddle the word of God. What idiots. Corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity. But as of God, in the sight of God, speak we in Christ. Now Paul says he did it for the members of the church back there, to see if that they'd be obedient. Amen. And what did they do? They put the man out. I'm sure that was hard because he probably had friends there, because weren't they not glorying in what he was doing? But they obeyed the gospel. They did what they were told. It caused the man to repent, and they brought him back into the church. Now, this is 29, 30 years after the Lord's resurrection, and this is going on in the church. So 2,000 years down the road, don't think we're going to be any better. If God was to manifest each and every one of our secret sins, we'd all be embarrassed. Amen. If he put out every dirty thing in our life since we've been saved, you'd be embarrassed. So don't be puffed up, he says. Don't act holier than thou. You got the same rotten, wicked flesh as this man had. He says there's no temptation taking you but such as common to man. How would you like God to reveal some of the secret thoughts you've had when you were praying? Or that boy or girl you saw walking down the street? Huh? That's why I like to stay dressed. I don't want to cause anybody to lust. That's why women ought to dress in modest apparel. And men. I asked a biker one time. Pat, I asked a biker one time. I said, if I come to your house, Russ, and I said, you and your wife are in your panties and bra and underwear, and I knocked on your door, would you let me in? He said, no, man. I said, why not? He said, we ain't dressed right. Don't you see my old lady? But the same people take the same garments, cut some of the cloth off, change the color, call it a bathing suit or a bikini, amen, and march right down the street. Amen. They lay on the beach like a bunch of lobsters. In heat. Amen. We were down here in the creek baptizing one time. You remember that?
I didn't go on that one.
Oh, you didn't go on that one? We went down number 6 here to where the swimming hole was, right there at the bottom of the big hill. And boy, that water was cold and nice in the summertime. But we go down there and we went down there to baptize. And we got down there and I still remember seeing this girl in the aqua-colored bikini. And people were swinging from the rope and drinking Budweiser and everything. And they were real nice. I said, hey, y'all mind if we use this a minute to baptize? Oh, no, go ahead. And they all got out and they're sitting on the bank. And the whole church walked down the hill there. And we got it. And I got out in the middle of the water. And we brought the person in to baptize them. And I preached a little message.
Oh.
And, if you, Brother Huckabee filmed it, so he's got it on tape somewhere. But anyway, this girl starts laughing while we're preaching. So I asked that question about the underwear. Next thing you know, She wasn't laughing anymore. Amen. You see, the women that want to cause men to lust, because, be honest with you, why do women wear their clothes the way they wear them? Because they want men to look at them. It used to be funny when I went into the truck stop and the waitresses and the people at the fuel desk, the women there, would always have their blouse unbuttoned about down to here. Amen. And they'd be leaning over like that. And all the drivers would be standing there. Well, after I got saved, not before, after I got saved, I said, ma'am, your button's up and I can see your breasts. Driver said, shut up, man, shut up. It's like she didn't know. Do you know that as Christians, if you do that, you're going to give an account for that? You're going to give an account for how we dress? Listen, this old body, this old flesh is wicked. I've known people that have been into pornography real heavy. And they couldn't watch a woman walk through the church without undressing her. They're no longer here. So if you dress like that, even the dresses sometimes are so tight and show everything, panty lines if they wear them, and they jiggle and wiggle. People are watching. Now, I said this before. If you say that don't bother you, you're either a liar or a queer. Amen?
Amen.
I mean, that's just the way it is. So, we've got a lot of things to look at in our lives that we're going to have to give an account to God for. If you want to be part of the Lord's army, you're going to have to do some work. Does he not say we're soldiers? We're supposed to put on the whole armor of God? Did he not say we're to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may be able to prove what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God? We're going to give an account. What did he say about the judgment seat of Christ? For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account for the deeds we did in our body, whether they be good or bad. These preachers that say you're going to a horse show, you might get a ribbon or you might not. I actually had preachers that come down and preach that, you know, it's not really a judgment. It's like a car show. Now it says judgment. Now, the Bible says there is no condemnation to them now that are in Christ Jesus, Romans chapter 8. Some of the Bibles change that to judgment. Now, we're not condemned with the rest of the world. The Lord said he came not into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So we're not under the condemnation of the law of God, but we will be judged by our deeds. Amen. That's why you need to stay clean. Confess your sin, stay prayed up, and get busy for the Lord, because we're going to give an account. Amen? Amen? Well, I'm like Megan's brownies. I'm done. Megan made brownies today. I haven't tried them yet.
May you be happier.
Amen. All right, Brother Steve, if you would dismiss us.
Fellowship, and Lord, to sing praises to you, Lord. And I just pray that, Lord, that as we all separate, Lord, that we go separate ways, Lord, that we, Lord, that there's so many things going on in this world, Lord, that, that we cling to you, Lord God. Get our eyes off what's going on in this world, Lord. Shut off the boob tube, and Lord, just concentrate on the things of you. Lord, just pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.